Welcome back, everyone. I'm at the Hearthstone World Championship with Rob. It's so good to see you. There was this guy. He looked a lot like you. He was on the casting desk. Did you see him on your way in or out?
I talked to him a little bit. Very, very upbeat, positive guy. Very much enjoyed talking to him. Love his work.
Yeah, brilliant. And positivity does seem to be the theme of the tournament. We have, of course, we have Hotform, who is like equivalent to positivity in my mind. He's got such a great community, such a positive outlook, and we're going to see a little from him today. But so many of the players.
Yeah, no, it's been, as it's kind of been stated over and over the course of this, it's been a very friendly gathering of players, and Hotform especially, as you talked about, Hotform has spoken to all of us at length about the merits of positivity, and very much enjoyed talking to him about that, so excited to see if maybe that kind of rubs off on the rest of the community, and we see a more positive Hearthstone community in 2016.
Oh, well, we have such a great community in chat. I see you in there giving your energy, sharing the rope, everything you need to do to get your favorite players to win. So if you want to join the conversation, it's hashtag HWC2015 on Twitter. And you want to say anything to the people, Rob?
Yeah, obviously, we love hearing back feedback about, you know, how everything's going, and we love hearing, you know, who you think is going to win and who you're supporting, so feel free to hit us, any of us up on our own individual Twitters, and we'll be tweeting and hanging out throughout the course of the day.
All right, thank you guys so much. We got more games coming. Don't go anywhere.
Welcome to our final Group C match. It is going to be a rematch of Hotform and Neelio. I don't know if I should say friends, but acquaintances who like to share some ideas from time to time.
Yeah, as we heard over the past couple of days when they first met, Neelio and Hotform have played each other on the ladder a number of times. They became friends discussing decks and strategy and their matches before. And this is the second time they have met in this event. Hotform was able to win the first time, but it was a very, very close match.
Yeah, it was extremely close. Hotform here, Jap was really struggling with his tempo mates, and I'm kind of curious to see if Hotform can perform better.
That's actually a theme we've sort of seen. Both Jab and Hotform playing this Tempo Mage deck, and it has kind of been a little inconsistent for the both of them.
That's always been the case.
Well, you are playing a deck with Flamewaker and Arcane Missiles and Unstable Portal. That's just something that kind of happens sometimes.
Yeah, it's his own decision to play that deck, and it can be extremely powerful, but it is inconsistent, like you mentioned.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Now, just a quick recap of how things are rolling through today. We have this match for you guys, and it will be followed by our last match of the this pre-BlizzCon tournament. So far, we have two European players who have qualified in the previous days. We have two Chinese players who qualified in the previous days. And today, so far, two Asia-Pacific players have qualified. But we have yet to have a qualifying player from the Americas region. Hotform perhaps can be the first candidate here. And followed up, Purple will have his chance as well.
Yeah, both Canadian players remaining in this event. The United States itself, unfortunately, is out of the running for the BlizzCon championship. Firebat will remain the only American BlizzCon champion for the time being, at least. But we are into game one here, where Hotform is playing his Tempo Mage deck, and Neelio is playing Warrior. And this is interesting, because I think some of the pick dynamic in terms of the order of what decks you choose to play when is based on what happened last time. And last time, Hotform played his Rogue deck. Hotform felt like his Rogue deck was his weakest deck against Neelio's lineup and didn't think Neelio would play Warrior first, wanted to try and get his Rogue deck out of the way.
Neelio tries to go Warrior first now.
Because you know that I know. It's this very Princess Bride poison thing going on here.
Yeah. Well, this opening with the random-based mage deck thing has not worked out today so far.
So this is one of the matchups where the mage deck can be pretty strong.
Yeah.
We saw that Hotform does play two copies of Mirror Image in his deck. And that's a card that, if he is able to pick it up early in the game, can do a lot of work protecting his minions from Neelio's weapons.
Yeah, this game is basically, do you have Fiery War Axe? If you do, I guess you win. But Mirror Image kind of sets up, so maybe it denies that a little bit.
And in this game, Neelio is the first player. He has a hand of all expensive legendary minions and a big game hunter, which isn't particularly good against Hotform's deck, while Hotform has opening hand of double Mana Worm.
Yeah, horrible hand from Neelio. No weapon to be found just yet. And Hotform in a good matchup with a good starting hand. Neelio really looking for the weapon too.
You see Hotform with a little bit of a smile and stretch there as Neelio takes his time on the first turn.
I'm kind of curious how you'd play this through with the mage, because you don't have any other spells, and even if you get ones that are somewhat mediocre, you'd want to save it for the Flame Waker. So would you consider doing turn one Mana Worm and turn two Mana Worm Coin Scientist?
That I think is the best way to use your resources efficiently here. You could play Mana Worm, then just coin Mana Worm. But that leaves you with, as you said, no more spells to buff them. And it looks like he is going to choose that. I think that picking up the second Mad Scientist may have somewhat informed that decision as well, because he does have another play on turn three other than the Flame Waker, which you would just be exposing to getting killed.
Yeah, but I completely agree with taking this aggressive approach here. He knows that even if Neelio has the Fiery War Axe, he can only kill one minion with it. Next turn, there's going to be another minion coming out from Hotform, and there's going to be that one extra minion going for face each turn.
How many worthless cards and cards above six mana can you possibly draw in a row?
I take offense to you calling Ysera worthless.
I was talking about Big Game Hunter.
How much is the total mana cost of Neelio's hand right now?
It is probably more than the total mana cost of Hotform's deck. It's not actually.
Oh, but just creatures? Maybe.
Minion-wise, it could be. It very well could be.
Because there are a ton of spells in Hotform's deck.
That's true. Yeah, Ysera, Grom, Justicar Trueheart, and Berengeddon here in Neelio's hand. All cards that are very, very powerful if you are able to bridge the gap to the late game, but we are on turn two.
Yeah. Neelio with absolutely nothing to play here, but still taking his time. We have seen this from him in his previous series as well. He really likes to think about the future turns and maybe try to bluff his opponent a tiny bit.
Yeah, Swiss Burn is pretty nice, but I think I'd like to see Mad Scientist first, because if you have exactly two mirror entities, you want to get one out immediately, so the chances of you drawing into one of whatever's left just diminishes greatly.
Sorcerer's Apprentice is also a card that you can play in the same turn as a spell to guarantee that mana discount, which increases your overall efficiency.
Yep.
Neelio picking up a Slam, it is a cheap card, not really a card that's great in this position. He could potentially slam the Mad Scientist, but neither of the other minions actually die to it. I wouldn't be surprised to see him slam one of those Mana Worms, just kind of dig for extra cards. He needs to find something that does something.
I wouldn't be surprised to see the Big Game Hunter. I mean, we're five spells short of Big Game Hunter being useful. And if it gets to that point, you're dead.
The problem there is that Big Game Hunter does just trade straight up with that Mad Scientist, which is not particularly compelling either.
Right, but if you slam here, what are you expecting to play?
It's not that you're thinking to play something
nothing,
turn, necessarily.
The hand is so horrible right now. I feel like he has to go with the slam just to draw and try to find something better for next turn.
Yeah, and that is what Neelio chooses to do. He wants to dig into his deck. He finds Bash.
That's something.
Which is okay.
Slam 2.0.
He would have much preferred to have that Bash on this turn to be able to immediately remove that Mana Worm and use this mana efficiently, playing the three-cost spell on turn three.
Gain some armor is pretty nice.
And this I like this play, which it looks like we're going to see from Hotform, which is Sorcerer's Apprentice and Frostbolt your face. Because normally, just throwing burn spells at your opponent's face early in the game is not a strategy that you typically employ. But against a warrior deck that is going into turn four, where you're afraid
of options already.
Well, you're afraid of something like Deathspite.
Yeah.
And when you Frostbolt and freeze your opponent, they can't play and use that Deathspite, which puts them farther behind in their ability to use removal effects.
Yeah, and not only that, but also using that Frostbolt right here, it buffs both of the mana worms, so it's effectively five damage right now.
It's a pretty good draw, though. He can do Bash Shield Slam to remove the two biggest threats on the board.
So that slam did draw Neelio to this four mana play this turn, which allows him to significantly reduce the incoming damage and gain a little bit of armor.
Yep. Anything else but a Bash Shield Slam would be a surprise here.
Though I expect that Neelio will take his time before ultimately playing those two cards.
Yeah, based on the previous turns.
I think there's actually some reason to decide whether you want to kill both Mana Worms or a Mana Worm and the Sorcerer.
That's
Apprentice.
True. That is true. Picking specifically which targets you'd like to kill is important. I believe Neelio does have Cruel Taskmaster in his deck, which could be some incentive to leave up the one health minion. Because he is so far behind, it's possible he just kind of needs to play to get luck. He kind of needs to play to draw specific things that will help dig him out of this.
Yep, starts with a Bash. Fairly obvious there, but this is a decision here. Do you want to kill the Mana Worm or the Sorcerer's Apprentice?
So the Sorcerer's Apprentice, both with two health, so maybe a little bit harder to kill, as well as the fact that it does represent, currently at least, the same amount of damage to the Mana Worm.
Yep. Flamestrike, not a helpful draw.
Yeah,
but
hot form on that draw, and because he's unwilling to play the Flamework, he's actually not developing much of a board. He actually lost more of a board than he was able to develop over the last turn from both players. So Neelio's starting to crawl back into this game, but 16 life is fairly low. This is kind of the range where a couple lucky draws in a row can seal the game for hot form.
Turn 5, we really wanted to play the Belcher, but nowhere to be found. Armorsmith, Big Game Hunter, kind of okay-ish, but the Big Game Hunter just going to trade with the Mad Scientist.
And we are seeing Hotform's draw there, that the Flame Strike. That's a card that's not particularly common in Tempo Mage decks because of the way that it works in this sort of dynamic. Tempo Mage decks, Flame Strike's great against aggressive decks, but if you do draw Flame Strike at a point where you're trying to apply pressure to a control deck like this Control Warrior, can really give you a little bit of a hiccup in the development of your curve.
Yeah, yeah. I think he's just looking for an efficient card to play along with the Flame Waker, possibly a Frostbolt, even like I think a Mirror Image would be pretty good.
Oh yeah, absolutely. That still remains a very powerful card. He does have a solid board here. Though Hotform probably is getting to the point now that we're at the reasonably later on in the game where Neelio has access to more mana, he's got to be afraid of Brawl. Mm-hmm. He doesn't want to necessarily just dump his hand into play and potentially lose all.
What do you think about pinging your own scientist after killing the Armorsmith?
It's an interesting play, and it's a heads-up play, noting that your opponent can potentially play a large minion next turn. I actually like that quite a bit. I think that potentially attacking both of his minions into the Armorsmith, removing it from the board, he could play his own Flamewaker, then ping one of his scientists. That puts up the Mirror Entity, because we know that Hotform just has the two Mirror Entities in his deck, and Neelio at this point knows this as well.
Yeah, that would be a really powerful play here. He kind of knows that Neelio doesn't have those weapons. If there was a weapon, it would have happened already.
Right.
So, hand is likely to be a lot of minions, and most of the minions in Warrior deck happen to be quite big. Let's see if he goes.
He's going to do it. I saw the target.
Yep. So Hotform really heads up play there, putting Neelio in a position where if he does play one of those large minions in his hand, will give Hotform a copy. There's Fiery Warax from Neelio, though. He really wanted that about four turns ago.
Fiery Warax is really strong because he can actually kill the other Mad Scientist to deny the follow-up Mirror Entity, and he can play Big Game Hunter, I guess. Mm-hmm. It's not great, but I guess.
I actually don't know that you'd want to play the Big Game Hunter here. I don't think you can afford to. There's just so much damage on your opponent's side of the board.
Yeah, but how do you ever come back if you don't do that?
It has to be some kind of Brawl. Shields blocks, maybe. Just exhaust Hot from on minions. But if he plays the Big Game Hunter, he's looking at an additional 4 and he's down to 17. He also won't be able to use the armor up this turn, which also is valuable.
Mm-hmm. If he did attack Fireworks into the Mad Scientist, he would go to 15, plays the Big Game Hunter, he leaves his opponent with 9 damage on board. That would actually just be lethal with the Fireball from his hand. I must choose. Though it's also possible that he just can't play around Fireball. It's possible that he is in a position where he needs to try and avoid that. He does choose to just take out the Mana Worm, currently the biggest threat.
I guess this means he's not playing the Big Game Hunter.
Yeah.
And in that case, you're just kind of hoping the Hotform draws that Mirror Entity.
Yeah, Hotform really close to lethal here.
Mirror image, though, as we were saying before, that helps protect his minions from the weapon, but it also just does 2 damage with that Flame Waker. Is this lethal? It's at least close. I think he's 2 damage off lethal with this if he goes to the Fireball to the face.
That's right, 2 off lethal.
He chooses not to.
Saves the Fireball for later on. And, Neelio trying another minion.
He can't play anything.
Yeah.
No.
Neelio, this Mirror Entity is very powerful in this situation. Preventing Neelio from developing any of those large minions that have been in his hand since the beginning of the game.
Shield Minion is the only one that kind of zeroes out, but you're still dead to Fireball. And if you were playing around Fireball last turn, you're feeling pretty depressed, at least.
this is a rough spot. I mean, Neelio's had a tough time of it this entire game. His opening hand was very bad. Didn't get that much better until Hotform was very far ahead.
Right. That's really what the mage needs. You just get a bit far ahead at the start, get some face damage in, and then at that stage of the game, the exact stage we're seeing right here, it becomes so difficult to play around every possibility that the mage might have, even like a one-card option like Fireball.
Mm-hmm. But I don't think there's any play for Neelio to survive anymore, considering the Fireball in Hotform's hand.
Yeah, I think there are exactly 0 plays available for Neelio.
I think his best play, given what he knows, is to play the Shield Maiden.
The only play.
Right. But he is going to find out that there's a Fireball waiting for him in Hotform's hand, and We are going to... Oh, and there's another one.
Double fireballs.
When it rains, it pours. Fire, at least.
Should he use the one he drew from the top to maybe try to tilt his opponent a little bit?
That is a little bit of psychology that does matter in these best of five series. If you can get your opponent a little bit rattled, oh, he got lucky, he drew the fireball. It's the sort of thing that, again, some players can throw them off their game.
All right, well, Hotform grabs his first win against Neelio from the Asia-Pacific region. So as we mentioned, every region except the Americas has had two players qualify already. So on one hand, you know, we kind of want to see a bit of a balance at BlizzCon, which might be achieved if Hotform and Purple end up qualifying through. But if any of their opponents take the game over them, the Asia-Pacific will actually have the most qualified players for the BlizzCon Finals.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of players coming into this were saying they felt like Europe and North America were the strongest regions, but there was a lot of question marks in the air about the strength of China and Asia-Pacific because they don't really get an opportunity to play in as many tournaments that at least we in the Western scene mm-hmm. have an opportunity to watch. But they have shown that they have a lot of very strong
yeah.
players.
Yeah, not many players actually know how good these Asia-Pacific players are, and now we have seen it over and over again. They keep taking these games and they keep playing well.
I mean, just last year, we saw Titular Celestial make it all the way to the finals of BlizzCon, where he eventually lost to Firebat, and he has continued to have a lot of success over the course of the previous year.
Yep, and this tournament alone has reminded that is still the case. So on that note, let's just hear a few more thoughts from Neelio to better understand the situation.
At first, my family didn't believe that my trip was paid by Blizzard. Like, they didn't believe that someone paid me to travel around the world to play Hearthstone. They believe that I was just lying, like, to play more Hearthstone. Like, I just do whatever I want, like, and Hearthstone is what I want to do and what I'm doing here at BlizzCon. I want to win a big tournament. Like, I'm not interested in small tournament. I want to win big tournaments like BlizzCon.
All right, well, he wants to take all the goods, as does every other player participating right now.
If he wants to win a big tournament, this is the biggest one.
Yeah, I mean, this is the biggest stage that you can play on in Hearthstone. And Neelio hoping to make his way to BlizzCon next week, but he's going to have to wait three games in a row. Mm-hmm.
And the matches here are really polarizing. We have the Rogue, quite good against the Paladin and the Hunter, I think, but very bad against the Warrior. And we have the Druid, perhaps in the exact opposite situation there. So the way that these matchups go down is going to dictate the results really heavily.
Yeah. Hotform previously was really hoping to dodge that Warrior honor. Deck with his Rogue. He still has to win with that Rogue, so he I believe, mostly wanted to play it against the Hunter, if I recall correctly, was where he felt like his best matchup was, or perhaps this Paladin deck. But he goes with his Druid for this game.
And it is against Paladin, so it seems like it's a favorable matchup for Neelio rather than Hotform, whereas if the Rogue was against the Paladin, it had a much higher chance mm-hmm. to beat the Paladin, and then eventually the Warrior had to beat the Druid, which was slightly problematic, even more so now that we noticed that Harrison Jones is part of the Druid list.
Yeah, we've seen a few Harrison Jones in this tournament, but they haven't been all that effective in general. And here Hotform does have it, but it's not even an obvious decision to keep it in the starting hand because it's so important to find those extra mana cards.
One of the issues playing against the Secret Paladin deck specifically is that you need to deal with their early aggression. A card like Harrison Jones is a powerful card to remove something like True Silver Champion or the Ashbringer from Tyrion Forgering, but against the Secret Paladin decks, you could just fall so far behind in the early turns of the game because of their aggression that even that marginal advantage is just not enough to win.
You can even just fall so far behind from the Mysterious Challenger.
Right.
The main difference between the Secret Paladin and just a regular mid-range type of Paladin deck is mid-range Paladin just plays usually one thing at a time. Here's something. Here's another thing. And if that thing's a True Silver, then Harrison Jones is spectacular. But when it comes to the Secret Paladin, it's like, here's six things. So Harrison Jones just doesn't really keep up with all the little things you have to deal with.
Yeah, a dreadful hand from Hotform here. That big Game Hunter might be valuable later on if there's something like Avenge landing on the Mysterious Challenger. But for now, the only playable card seems to be the Innervate. There's nothing to Innervate.
He could Innervate at the big Game Hunter.
He could.
Probably won't be a play that we see, but...
I don't think that's even impossible. We know that Hotform is running double big game Hunter in his deck, which I think actually helps him against the mysterious challenger issue. If he's able to clear up the board going into turn six, Big Game Hunter is the most valuable card you can have because it triggers the event triggers on the mysterious challenger after a get down.
Yeah, if you that's the key though. If you're able to keep them to having a clear board when they do play the challenger, because and that's a pretty strong draw from Hotform there. He needed something and he finds the piloted shredder. So that's gonna allow him to be the one who is ahead on the board.
Yeah, pretty nice draw there for Hotform. Wild Growth would have also been great, but having something to play here over the hero power is excellent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you kind of want to activate your Avenge with the Muster for Battle, but if you do, you delay your Mysterious Challenger by one turn. And Mysterious Challenger, the earlier it's played, the more insane it is. Mm-hmm. So it's really a tough decision here, as the coin can represent so much win potential in this matchup.
Yep, it's likely he's going to hold on for the coin, for the challenger. Here, Shielded Minibot. Yeah, I mean, why not? That's often the best possible turn two that you can make. Neelio. Normally when we see players take their time like this, they might be seriously considering the Muster for Battle, but in Neelio's case, we have seen him take a long time and then end up with the obvious play anyway.
Yeah, the Shielded Minibot makes it so you can Muster for Battle and use that to finish off the Shredder next turn. And that's unlikely to be punished. It's just against the druid, you never know for sure.
So Force of Nature, a second copy. Certainly not what Hotform is looking for here, but
no, not at all.
He is able to get this minibot off the board. And he wants to do this before there's a second minion, because it's likely that that secret is something like Avenge.
That was a pretty aggressive play. We have to keep in mind that Neelio, alongside most of the players from the Asia region, are running double Redemption.
Yeah.
So the chance that you play a Redemption to go into a Shielded Minibot is very high. Mm-hmm. And if Redemption did come out here and he had the Muster, it probably would have ended the game.
Yeah, Hotform would have been heavily punished for that, but he took his chances and it kind of worked out.
There are so many different situations that can come up given the variety of secrets the Paladin deck does play, that in many cases there's going to be a play that will punish you for whatever you do. So you just have to kind of figure it out, walk through it, and be like, okay, this is the specific line I'm going to take, and use the information you gain from the actions that you take in the game to try to sort things out.
Yep, Neelio once again burning some rope, goes for the Muster for Battle, and like he has, take out the shield, the part of the shredder here. Mm-hmm. See what pops out.
Oh,
wow, dear.
Well,
that might not be that bad.
We have seen... Oh, well, look at Hotform's hand. That's pretty bad.
I think you can just Wild Growth here.
You can. It's an option.
I don't think it's a bad option.
There's not much else he can do.
I think you'd rather Wild Growth than have something that is not Lorewalker Cho in play.
Okay.
Yeah. Kinda.
And here, with that Avenge that Neelio has up, Hotform is going to be punished if he does decide to hero power and kill one of those minions.
It looks like he's again taking that risk, though.
Well, no, he may just be going to the face.
I don't think so.
No, yeah. He does kill a minion, okay.
Takes the chance that this time around it is going to be that Avenge. It could have been a competitive spirit in that case, the attack would have worked out, but it happens to be the Avenge, and Neelio has that 4-3 on the board right now.
And now Neelio does have, he has that Wild Growth. He could Wild Growth and play Minibot this turn. Well, he can kill the Cho.
Oh, that's right.
Because
he can
of
kill the
Avenge,
and then
he can
Wild
kill
Growth.
Cho and then Wild Growth, which will enable him to play Mysterious Challenger without even using his coin next turn.
Yeah, that seems like easily the strongest play here.
Yeah,
quite powerful indeed. Well, it's easy to predict the role, but at this stage, I guess. Every single turn, Neelio has been considering his option for a long time.
I mean, it's definitely a variety of options he does have, particularly with the coin. I mean, he could choose to even just coin Lotheb this turn.
That just feels bad, because if you do that, you don't really have much of a power play next turn. Mm-hmm. While Wild Growth Shield Minibot when you're ahead really is quite fine.
Well, he could potentially play Coghammer and Minibot next turn as well. So I like this
base.
Play.
He's got heat to show around.
Okay, interesting. I think his thought process... Oh. Okay. I think his thought process here is that he thinks that if Hotform uses his mana to continue wild growthing rather than actually playing things that impact the board, that he's going to be just ahead. And that one of Hotform's best ways to get back from this position is something like Force of Nature. And that would, with the Cho on the board, Force of Nature would give Neelio a Force of Nature, which would allow him to press his advantage.
Interesting decision to deal that 2 extra damage to the Cho. I kind of like it, because now it's easier for him on the following turns to get rid of it if he needs to.
Yeah, absolutely. If things go badly.
Yeah.
Well, I still think we're going to see the Mysterious Challenger here. It's hard to top that. And maybe even the Zombie Cho. Really doesn't seem too bad.
He'd have to use his coin for that, which would mean he'd have to clear Cho. He might just want to do that this turn, but I think given his line of play, he wants to leave that Cho in play and just give himself the opportunity to kill it later on if he so chooses.
Yeah, I
imagine that we may see him just clear off this this keeper and then just play Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah,
I really think that he's going to keep the Cho around since he chose to do it last turn.
All right, well, if we do see that play, the Big Game Hunter is going to have a 50% chance of being very successful.
Yeah, if Hotform does choose to use his hero power attack, that would trigger the Noble Sacrifice that would come from the Seals Challenger and then the Avenge. And that could be the window that Hotform
needs
to get back.
The thing is, Neelio knows that Hotform has 2 Big Game Hunters. Again,
just give him the coin right back.
Not too worried about the Cho.
I think because he knows that Hotform has 2 Big Game Hunters, he's not worried about giving his opponent a coin, because it's really just more important that he doesn't get tempoed up by a BGH here. Having that extra target on the board makes that a little bit less likely.
Absolutely. The coin here, also just give the coin back to Neelio. He knows that it is difficult for Hotform to do anything to get rid of that Loremaster Cho in play, and leaving it there does mean that, again, those Force of Natures, Savage Roar, all of these cards, Hotform can play them, but Neelio would just get a copy.
Hotform getting a Darnassus Aspirant, not exactly what he was looking for.
No, not quite.
And Hotform's hand looked bad earlier on. It looked even worse when that Cho came down, and he is under a lot of pressure right now.
Yeah, he has to just hero power here and hope that the Avenge lands on that Mysterious Challenge to have some kind of like reasonable play with the Big Game.
Yeah.
If it does, he's really not in that bad shape. We have to keep in mind he's at 25 and his opponent has a Cho on the board. He's basically at 30. So if BGH can land, if the Avenge does go on the 6-6, that is the turn of the game that Hotform needs.
Yep.
No. Oh man, are we going to see a coin Force of Nature?
I believe we might. I think. I wonder if Hotform roped here. We saw a look of exasperation from Hotform.
He's shaking his head. Yeah. I think he might have missed another.
Yeah, that's one of the things playing in Secret Paladin, because of the animation times of the. He actually totally misses his attack.
Man.
That was an absolute disaster of a turn for Hotform.
I think there's lethal now.
I think that might
easy
just be
lethal.
He's Force of Nature.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's 13, 19 in play plus the
19, 26.
Is he just not gonna kill?
He's 2 over.
Just going for the extended VM.
All right, and Neelio.
Extended DM.
Neelio takes that game. And one of the things about a card like Lorewalker Cho, it creates these awkward situations that requires players to do things that are kind of out of their comfort zone, not necessarily things they've practiced. And there, you know, Hotform had to work through everything and didn't quite have time to make his play once he reached his decision, thanks to the animation times of the sequence.
I mean, even if he did have the time to kill off the 6-6 there with a Force of Nature, yeah, he wouldn't have died that turn, but he was extremely far from winning. The only chance you really had was the Big Game Hunter being able to land on the Mysterious Challenger. If that happened, he was actually, you know, challenging the board in a reasonable way. He may have had to burn Savage Roar to actually kill off his Lorewalker Cho, which could have ended very badly in a few turns afterwards.
Absolutely.
But not necessarily. I feel like if the Big Game Hunter came out, he could have won that game, and it wouldn't have been that unlikely.
Yeah, he definitely would have still had a chance, but it would have been tough. I would have still favored Neelio over Hotform in that situation, even if the Avenge landed on this Challenger.
Yeah, it was a very rough spot. Neelio got off to an excellent start, and Hotform didn't quite have the start he needed.
All right, well, Neelio evens out the set. It is 1-1 with that victory. And we have a few more thoughts from our recent winner.
It was very exciting to compete in 2 qualifiers, Southeast Asia and APAC, because I like to travel a lot. And I also had an advantage because I was in the top 8 in Southeast Asia standing, so I had 2 buys. I just had to play, win a few games to get into Southeast Asia qualifier, and a few more games to get into APAC. So that was not challenging at all. That was very exciting for me.
And game three is underway. Now Neelio got the better side of the matchup, I guess, mind game slash RNG, because it is a combination of those two, I suppose. Will it happen again? Now it is even more polarizing with the Paladin out, as the Druid really wants to go against the Warrior and really does not want to go against the Hunter, while the Rogue wants to do the exact opposite. Actually, the Rogue kind of wanted to beat up the Paladin before it ended up grabbing that win. So the Rogue is in much worse of a spot than it was before the last match. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, certainly. And I was about to say, I expect Hotform to play his Rogue here, because if Hotform were to play his Druid, and Neelio managed to play his Warrior in one, or played the Hunter in one,
yeah,
that would mean that Hotform would have to beat the Warrior deck with his Rogue deck.
Which is not going to happen. Which,
yeah, that's such a bad matchup for him. Mm-hmm.
So it is very reliant on this game here. Even though it is 1-1, if the Rogue loses, it'll have to go up against the Warrior and challenge extreme odds. Mm-hmm. But I think Hotform here is favored. Neelio is playing a fairly aggressive Hunter list. From what I remember, I think he was playing something like hybrid-ish Hunter.
Yeah, we do see that Argent Horse Rider in his hand, which is indicative of less of a mid-range build, more of a hybrid-style build, a little bit more aggressive than the Dr. Boom versions, like we see Jab play.
Yeah. But the Rogue can certainly deal with that. If you get a good board clear, if you get a punishing backstab or SI7 opener, if you get like the right piece of the puzzle in the opening sequences of the game, the Rogue can just shut down the aggression in a very big way.
Yep, and Hotform did get the coin and the SI agent to start things off.
Neelio with Web Spinner. This is one of the more mid-rangey cards. But he has a pretty good opening here, Web Spinner.
He has a good 1-2-3, and if Vile Teacher comes down, Unleash goes for the win.
And the bow is pretty key as well. Because
in this matchup, it's one of the best cards.
Because the Rogue deck does use cards like SI Agent to try to get ahead. The coin SI Agent turn 2 to kill something on Neelio's side of the board is one of Hotform's best reactions to an opening from Neelio. But that bow will be able to take that out, and he actually has a couple of minions that are not particularly great targets for that SI Agent.
So much so that he might just not do that.
It's true.
Like, would you really consider SI7ing a haunted creeper? I don't know. That's something to think about.
I'd potentially kill a web spinner.
Good. No. It seems so weak, because it only gives the hunter more power.
It's true. Yeah, on the creeper, certainly.
Well, the draw B, that looked like a low-cost card. It is a fan of knives. That could be pretty good.
Where do you see these cards coming off? I only ever see them when they actually go into the hand field at the top.
Right on the corner, you see them flip around just a little bit. Yeah.
Oh, wow. I have not trained myself to look for that just yet, but maybe I'll learn someday.
Maybe my lack of sleep is just producing some hallucinations. Well, Mad Scientist seems like a stronger play than the Creeper from Neelio's side, but it is one that can be countered far more easily.
Yeah, I think if you're in Neelio's position, you're trying to think of, okay, well, what is the best thing that Hotform can do here? And one of the best things is that coin SI agent. So I would not be surprised to see him play the Creeper, despite the Scientist being the more straightforwardly powerful play.
Yeah, it is more value in the creature, and you get the synergy with a secret for your bow next turn.
Yeah, so playing the Scientist here, even though the coin SI deals with the Scientist, the bow is the perfect answer to that agent. Quickly.
So you think the Mad Scientist is better just because you can answer it?
I like the Scientist because of the bow in his hand. If he didn't have the bow, then it wouldn't be quite as good.
Mm-hmm. Well, we do see Hotform pick up a preparation, which, while strong, not necessarily what he's looking for in this particular moment, he's going to use his coin SI agent to remove the Mad Scientist.
This guy's it still looks fine. Preparation is a card that often is very powerful in conjunction with spell damage, which he does have.
Yes.
He has in the form of the Blood Mage and in the form of the Azure Drake.
Neelio picking up an excellent play for his next turn with that Piloted Shredder. I have to imagine we'll see the Eaglehorn Bow take down the SI agent to maintain the board presence that Neelio is looking for.
Yep, seems fairly obvious. The weapon's still going to have another judge in it, so if there was another tree drop coming out from Hotform, like a Farseer or Second Agent, you could just deal with that as well. Pile this Shredder perfect for the next turn.
And these players, they did face each other before. They've also certainly been watching each other's games, at least when they found out they were going to have a rematch, to be sure they know the contents of each deck. Mm-hmm. I don't quite recall exactly which traps Neelia was playing with when we saw him play earlier.
Yeah, it was quite a few days since then. I do recall there at least being freeze traps. I don't know if they were a mix of freeze traps, but we'll have to see. Overall, though, these players are fairly close. They're just kind of acquaintances in the world of Hearthstone. They have ran up against each other many times on ladder, and from that, you know, they've talked a little bit about their strategies, and that kind of gives them a little bit more insight into what each one is playing. Now, the Hyenas is a really fun card. This is a card that, you know, in the early world of Hearthstone, people actually played this because you had so many disposable beasts, and now with Unleash in hand, you know, that situation might arise again.
Yeah, it can be quite powerful. Rogue usually doesn't get all that many minions on the board unless there's a Violet Teacher spawning those 1/1 tokens.
But this turn, I have to imagine we'll see that Pilot Shredder come down. Shredder, one of the cards that has been responsible for at least something of a decline in the popularity of Rogue, the fact that there are sticky minions like the Shredder that are much more difficult for the Rogue to efficiently remove, causes them some difficulty if they don't have a card like Sap to just bounce it back to the hand. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I remember when Druid was dominating Control Warrior, it was largely because you could, like, Spectral Knight, and the Warrior would have to take 12 damage removing it.
Spectral Knight was great.
That's basically what Shredder does most of the time.
It's been a while since we've seen Spectral Knights being played.
Sadly. That was a cool card.
I loved me a Spectral Knight. All right, so Hawkworm does use the Blood Mage Thalnos to trigger the combo on Eviscerate, allowing him to take out the Shredder,
very,
and then Preparation Fan. He just wants to get the board clear, I believe.
Yeah, and I think he wants to pop the Freeze Trap on that 1-1 minion.
Yeah, this creates an interesting situation where the Blood Mage is either going to deal with the bow or the Freezing Trap.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and we mentioned about how Hawkworm might not be in the deck, but there it is. It does seem to be like a fairly true list for mid-range Hunter. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just a little bit of extra aggression from those Argent Horse Riders. I'm curious if we might see the Hyena into Unleash this turn.
This turn?
It clears that, protects your trap, and you get a 4-power minion in play.
Okay. Yeah, it's not that bad, actually.
It's actually pretty good. It is vulnerable to a possible Azure Drake into Backstab, unfortunately, for Neelia, but it... He's
you'd
unlikely
have
to find
think,
a great opportunity
you'd
to use
You'd have to think if Prep Fan was used, that Backstab doesn't exist in the hand.
That's a good point.
That is, yeah, that's definitely...
He's not going to unleash just yet. Going to use that bow to get rid of the Blood Mage. See what Hawkworm picks up. Oil. A little bit early for an oil.
And then Backstab.
There is the Backstab. They would have had to be punished for that play, I suppose.
Yep. And we do see the Backstab take out the Hyena before it can grow bigger, feasting on the other dead beasts. Another
kill command
for Neelia. That's pretty powerful, but unfortunately he's going to just need to use it to remove this Azure Drake, I think.
Does he? He has the trap, and a 7-mana Azure Drake in the hand of a Tempo Rogue is really worthless card.
I believe he does know that Hawkworm has South Sea Deckhand in his deck.
That is true.
So I think that he may want to protect his Freezing Trap using that kill command. He doesn't really have another play this turn
either.
Right,
if he had another play, I think he would have seen the other play made, but you're absolutely right. I think kill command has to be played, but I do think he's actually considering just pointing it at the Rogue's face.
Yeah, but considering the rest of the hand, he does have that Dr. Boom for turn 7, so removing the spell power makes it more difficult for Hawkworm to deal with that. Mm-hmm. If, let's say, the Dr. Boom was an Arcane Golem, then he would also have more reach to end the game faster.
Yeah, Neelia has the tools with that Dr. Boom to play for a little bit of a longer game. And this also does allow him to use his Hero Power this turn, getting a little bit of extra damage and going to 24 for Hawkworm. Still at a reasonably healthy life total.
Yeah, I mean, just being 1/6 down is not really too big of a deal here.
Oh, it's an explosive trap. So that's even more reason that he would want to kill that Azure Drake.
Yeah, that is the decisive reason. That may actually have been what blew Hawkworm in. Though, kind of artificially, like, we know Kill Command was basically the only he could play, But on Hotform's side of the board, he's like, wow, he really tried to struggle to defeat my Azurdrake. That must not be a freeze trap.
I mean, there's also very little cost to attacking with his weapon there. He's going to want to re-weapon anyway in a future turn.
Yeah.
But Neelio, this Dr. Boom doesn't look quite as exciting now that the Azurdrake is down on the board. But still probably his best play. That second Unleash the Hounds, not a card he's looking for here.
One of the
weak cards in this matchup.
Well, Dr. Broom is not only just a good 7 drop, it would also be a good 8 drop. And it's also a big creature that that does extremely well against Rogue, as sapping it really just feels very bad.
Man.
I can't see why there's much thought when it comes to this play. He definitely just might be doing his thing where he thinks about future possibilities.
Yeah, he has been taking his time on pretty much every turn. This no different. Boom comes down with his Boom Bots.
Okay, can we see a big Blade Flurry here? Could that be the play?
We could. He could trade the Drake into the Boom, make the weapon, attack into the Creeper, and get a full clear. What other options does he have? He could go for Sap on the Boom, but yeah, it doesn't feel good. Those Boom Bots are so annoying, and they might take out the potential low tap and the Drake.
Sometimes they only do 2 damage pop. But sometimes it's 10.
I mean, there is Azurdrake's on the board, the natural enemy of the Boombot. Mm-hmm. And Lothep.
I guess that means we're going to see the Sap.
Yeah, imagine if we do see Lothep, we will also see Sap.
This might really be a disaster here.
It's a little bit of a dangerous line of play, though. It is potentially setting up for... It could be lethal next turn, I believe.
Yeah, depending on the Boombot. Mm-hmm.
If Hotform is able to... keep both these minions in play.
Good. Even though it's 3 face, which seems kind of bad.
Hotform with his hands together.
He's very happy about
please
that.
Please, no. Oh, the natural predator of the Azurdrake comes and defeats it.
Yeah, Neelio's very relieved there. He knew some trouble was coming his way next turn.
There is the Argent Horse Rider that Neelio picked up. He would have a removal option even if that Azurdrake had survived, but definitely much more efficient for him to just play this Dr. Boom again this turn.
Absolutely.
But if Hotform does have Tinker Blade Flurry next turn with this Lothep, that's not lethal, is it?
No, I think he needs to pick up another Tinker Oil.
Either another oil or would a deadly poison be enough?
Another oil, he wouldn't be able to cast another oil because he needs to get a new weapon as well.
Oh, I see, yes.
So it would be 1 mana off from filling 2 oils. Deadly poison, prep, oil, flurry, that's quite a bit of damage. But is it enough?
And Shredder.
Well, Dr. Boom back for round 2.
And this is what we're saying, that the difficulty in dealing with Dr. Boom for these rogue decks. Those Boom Bots, they did a lot of work. They killed that Azurdrake. And now Hotform uses his preparation for Sprint. He may be looking for perhaps another copy of Sap to get Dr. Boom down back again. Deckhand.
Ooh. Is there a way to even deal with the Boom? He could oil here without the weapon for the trade for the Boom. But
I think it might be even simpler than that. I think he could weapon up, play a deadly poison, and just Sautsy and Lothep into Dr. Boom. Mm-hmm. But that makes it so your oil next turn is going to be a lot weaker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then he won't have any chance to lethal Neelio.
On the flip side, I believe Neelio might have a kill here even with bad Boombot RNG, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, the problem from the perspective of the rogue is that you can't just be looking to deal with what your opponent plays. You have to be looking to close the game because you're using your health total as a resource, and your opponent is playing Hunter and has Steady Shot, which puts you on a clock.
Yeah, Hotform does make the play that is going to keep him
and
in the game.
And there's a big cat.
Yeah, a really big cat.
So Neelio counting out what sort of damage he has and what the next few turns are going to look like, I imagine. I would not be surprised to see. Well, it's interesting. The big cat seems good, but
I'm surprised to just all face so the Boom Bots.
It doesn't do anything right now.
Threaten lethal off a Blade Flurry.
So the damage from those, he can do 3 if he plays the Horse Rider and uses his hero power. That's 4, 5, 6, 7, putting Hotform down to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Where's the 12?
The kill command phase.
Oh, well, I'm not saying including that.
I have to include that.
Well, I'm just kind of for the next turn as well. If you have to attack again with anything.
I think I like that play the most. I think I like just getting the rogue down so low that you make him sweat if he plans on blade throwing the boombox.
He does just go with the Hyman and the Horse Rider. Don't worry, so the Horse Rider not only does the 2 damage that Steady Shot would do this turn, but also puts a body into play that your opponent has to deal with as well.
Yeah, the Hyman quite powerful, and Neelio already saw one sap go.
Wow, sap. But very, very good draw.
Oh, it's most important draw.
Yeah, that sap is going to at least stave off Scar for one more turn. But
it's like, how do you stay alive here? I mean, you have the kill command, you have the unleash. And he's going for Vot. This is just suicide here.
The Violet Teacher from Hotform's side looks like what he wants to do in order to get a board presence. But we know those two copies of Unleash the Hound are really going to punish him.
Yeah, that's likely to be it, no matter where the boom was. But what if the boom was killed at 1-1, actually? That would have
actually could end up going well for Hotform.
Right, because it would deny more damage from the Unleash the Hounds.
I think there's a reasonable chance we see him attack into the Spider to try and clear.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You don't want to leave those 1-1s behind.
But this is leaving Hotform at very, very low health against Unleash and Kill Command.
Boombox just have to kill those 1-1s.
We see Neelio. Oh, we see a little pump of the fist from Neelio. I think they may have lived.
I think that is going to be it.
So Unleash, Kill Command. Even just with that, with just the Unleash Kill Command, it's enough.
Yeah. And that was a huge game. I mean, Rogue, I think, was slightly favored to win that game, but it just had to win the game because in Conquest format, Neelio only has the Warrior left. Hotform not only has to beat that with a Druid, which is pretty likely, but he has to do so with a Rogue deck that we just saw, which is extremely unlikely.
Yeah, this is a pivotal game in this match. Hotform has been saying he really wants to dodge that Warrior with his Rogue, but that's the only deck Neelio has left.
Yeah. No, he has to play that matchup. But it is possible that Neelio is going to draw all of his expensive legendaries once again, like he did in game one.
I suppose so. Neelio is basically on match point here. On the line is a spot for the BlizzCon finals, and also Trump in the other regions by putting up that third player from the Asia Pacific on the finals.
And right now, there are no representatives of the Americas region who will be playing on the stage at BlizzCon. If Hotform loses, it's all down to purple in the next match.
Yeah, it's going to be really tough, though. But excited to see if Hotform chooses to take the easy or the hard matchup first. What do you guys think?
I think from Hotform's perspective, I would imagine that he may go with the Rogue first. Just he knows he has to win with both. He just wants to go in and not necessarily put himself under any undue stress of, you know, okay, maybe I can win this, but he has to get that out of the way in order to win at all.
Right. He could try to get momentum on his side, though.
It's true.
That Druid win first, or likely Druid win. It's not an automatic win, obviously.
Of course.
And some players even argue that it's not that good for the Druid.
Well, I don't know if momentum matters for much because he still has to win with that Rogue, and that's really the big hurdle.
Yeah, that's serious.
That is the big hurdle. Anyway, guys, we will get back to our games shortly, but before that, let's hear about Hotform and what motivates him to play, what he'll do if he'll win.
So there are things that tend to take me away from pro gaming. I did the law school application, and I did pretty well on that, but I've decided to take a year in between. That feels like a really big commitment in my life, and this is a lot of fun. I've enjoyed gaming my entire life, so I want to try this out, you know, experience the world a bit first before I make that big of a decision. I do have plans for the money if I win, not all of it, of course, but I want to take a vacation for sure. I think a vacation I'm really interested in right now is going to Australia. I could just picture like renting a Jeep and kind of driving through the outback with some of my friends. I think that would be such a great experience, so I would love to use the money towards that type of vacation.
All right, well, it is match point for Neelio, and Hotform is the one with the far bigger hurdle ahead.
It's true. He not only has to win 2 games in a row, but has to do one of them in a very, very bad matchup. I believe he estimated his chances of winning the matchup at less than 20%.
Wow, that's really low. I didn't think it's that bad.
That was what he himself said the other night when we were talking to him about his strategy initially going into the matchup with Neelio. And he felt like it was such a bad matchup that it was crucial that he dodged it in the deck selection phase, and now there's no way he can. He has to get through that warrior.
Yeah, but I think the biggest thing in that matchup is whether or not the warrior draws the sufficient amount of weapons. Because if even Fire War Axe gets easily 2-for-1, kills the agent, kills the front half of the Shredder, but if there's no weapons to be found, those early minions might chip up enough to be able to end the game before we get to those expensive warrior legendaries.
There's the flip side of that. There could just be the 4-weapon draw, which turns out to be maybe even worse than the no-weapon draw.
Well, in this matchup, it's actually not clear that that's true, because
there's so few minions, right?
Right, the Rogue deck doesn't have that many minions and so much shit, but it looks like Hot Form does choose to go with his Druid deck. He wants to, you know, perhaps get on the board here, you know, get a little bit of momentum, and try to go into his final game, at least having won the last one.
I believe this is extremely one-sided for the Druid. Maybe even so as it is in reverse with the Rogue. Not just because it's Druid, which is traditionally good, but we have to remember Hotform is playing a double BGH Harrison Jones Druid here.
It's true.
He's really, really teched against an already good matchup.
Yeah, but I also tend to favor the Druid, but I have actually heard some players, like KitKats was who is known for his warrior gameplay, actually favors the warrior over the druid because of the recent expansion that gave cards like Bash to the warrior.
Yeah, Bash is a huge deal. Bash is a card that allows you to deal with a card like Piloted Shredder, a card like Darnassus Aspirant, and also Darnassus Aspirant, while it makes the deck stronger in a lot of matchups, it's not actually necessarily that good against warrior because it makes cards like Fiery War Axe that otherwise weren't particularly strong against the druid deck a very, very good card.
All right, well, Nelio was certainly very happy with that opening hand, but Hotform's is pretty good as well. Yep. He's just missing that big threat that he is likely to play on turn 3.
We see a little sigh from Hotform as we once again get into Nelio's rope on turn 1. He's you know, making the most use of the time he has available. And we've talked about this a little bit before. It's not that Nelio has a particularly difficult decision this turn. He's not debating, okay, should I coin armor up? Should I coin armor smith? He only has the 75 seconds each turn. He's planning out his turns in advance. He's thinking, okay, if this happens, I want to do this, and ensuring that he has a game plan moving forward.
Well, you talk about how he actually has options to do things in this turn one, but in his first, in his opening warrior game against the mage, He literally doesn't have a one drop in his deck.
Right.
And Hotform was kind of giggling a little bit, like, what's going on? Realizing that fact.
Mm-hmm. I also think that it's possible that one reason why Nelio is taking such a long time is to calm down his nerves, because we have seen him react fairly strongly to some situations that have been unfortunate for him.
So that Darnassus Aspirant for Hotform, still nothing to follow up. Nelio. He has a couple of options here, actually. That Bash is a card that he could choose to play this turn with the coin to potentially keep Hotform off of that mana acceleration.
I don't think it's that important. I think what's really important is that you get the Deathspite out as early as possible because it activates not only the Execute, but the Acolyte as well.
Definitely. I if I were in Nelio's shoes, I'd probably just play the Armorsmith this turn.
I would just not coin this turn. That's the only requirement
coin, yes,
for me.
Yes, coin is a very good card in this. The way that this dynamic works out, the Deathspite, more powerful when it can come down earlier and is more likely to kill the minions that are in play.
I wouldn't hate it, though, like, to go coining out the Bash here. We can see that there's nothing coming. Nothing bad is going to happen if he leaves up the Aspirant. But Druid having that extra mana crystal, it can be threatening. Turn 3, Piloted Shredder, not something you want to see.
And Dr. Boom, that's not something that Hotform can play this turn.
It's going to be one man off, 2 turns in a row now.
Yeah, looks like it. Unless he picks up a second inner raid.
So Hotform would have loved for that to be, perhaps, Emperor Tharason. But
I think we're probably going to see a Wrath for 1. There's not many minions that are important and die to Wrath in this deck. Mm-hmm. And you often just need a cycle.
Yeah.
Especially in this case where you don't really have anything to play if something goes wrong next turn.
I really like that. Considering his hand too, he wants to get to his lords as soon as possible. He does go for a Wrath for the 3 instead.
Oh, wow.
That is a bit surprising to me.
Yeah, I'm pretty surprised to see the Wrath for 3 rather than Wrath for 1 and just attack with both things. Attack with his hero power and his aspirant.
Yeah,
I'm actually surprising. Surprised enough that I wouldn't mind just a Bash here.
I mean, this looks to Nelio like maybe Hotform's trying really hard to protect this aspirant from any sort of removal, including execute, because that's really the reason you'd make that play.
Right. It,
I mean, you would be giving your opponent armor for Shield Slam, which is another possible reason that you wouldn't want to just throw all of that into the Armorsmith there.
Drawing that second bash, I think it makes it more likely that he's just going to bash that minion here to keep that coin for maybe to play one of those big legendaries that he will eventually draw, like Ysera for turn 8. It's quite huge.
Yeah, the Druid, despite Big Game Hunter, has a little bit of difficulty dealing with some of those big minions in the Warrior deck. And the ability to get something like down like Justicar Trueheart early and be able to keep getting your armor total up is a big deal. So now Hot Form down to 4 mana, so Innervate again can't play Dr. Boom. Or Ancient of Lore. This is... Hero. Oh, and you see Neilio literally just pump his fists here as Hot Form does nothing but Hero
Power.
He is
doing very, very well in this
he is in a
what
tremendous
is supposed
position.
To be a bad matchup.
Yeah. Hot Form has some powerful plays for later on, but turn 4 Hero Power pass, that is truly dreadful.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen the swipe face on turn 4 a few times in this tournament. Why didn't it happen there?
I imagine he may be looking for another option for Swipe.
Oh, I see. Swipe, though, is actually often an almost worthless card against Warrior, as everything is way bigger or way smaller, and often you don't want to do one damage to like an Acolyte on the back end.
Yeah, Swipe and Wrath are your best cards in Druid against a lot of aggressive decks, but against a deck that is primarily full of large minions like Control Warrior, both of them are really weak. That's part of the reason I was so surprised that Hotform made that play that he did with the full 3 damage Wrath rather than trying to just dig for another card.
Absolutely. Neilio here with a few options. He could Acolyte, he could play the Death Spite preemptively, but that's unlikely because he knows the Hotform is running on Harrison Jones. So risking that is not something
you play Death Spite, you have to go face.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And going for face, they're not so valuable. Hotform choosing to go with the Lore before the Dr. Boom. In many matchups, you want to go for the Boom first, but he realized that Neilio is playing Big Game Hunter, has those executes, so getting those extra cards to have better chances to having powerful turn 6 is a reasonable play.
Yeah, because if he had just played Dr. Boom, he, in his hand, currently has nothing to do the next turn. Dr. Boom may be the most immediately impactful play, but it's more important for Hotform's chances to win that he's able to develop his board for the next several turns as well.
Yeah, and
this is actually a pretty tough play. Maybe one of the cleanest ways to deal with it is Fire War Axe Bash, but with 2 Deathbite in hands now, you really want to use one of them.
Yeah, but how do you? That would mean that he would have to either execute or use the front half of the Belcher.
What if he just Death Spites and just leaves the 5-1 on the board?
It's going to straight for the Belcher. That's a little bit
weak. Belcher doesn't like that play.
No, the Belcher does not approve.
Use the Bash!
I think it's fair to just go for the Fiery War Axe and use the Bash, because that Fiery War Axe in his hand is also going to be fairly worthless for later on. So getting some use out of it now is an okay thing.
So he chooses to do it in this order because it does preserve the armor from the bash. If he had bashed first, he would have taken the damage and lost that armor, which is important for cards like Shield Slam later on.
Right. And it's generally just good practice.
Yeah, absolutely.
There is the other side
that is
really
a huge draw for Hot from there. The Emperor Tharisin with 6 other cards in hand.
Yeah, that Ancient of Lore drop paid off.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Really, really well.
And it's interesting, too, because Neilio chose to use his coin to play the Sludge Belcher. He could have just played Death Spite and attacked the face, which would have given him a clean way to just clear off a 5-5 on the following turn, and then play the Sludge Belcher as well. Now, Neilio still has just a bunch of weapons, and he's facing down this Emperor without a clean way to deal with it. He doesn't have that bash anymore.
Yeah, he has to use either the Execute or the Belcher now to get rid of that. And
I like the Belcher a lot more, because you can play the Shield Maiden for tempo, and you still have the 1-2 taunt to activate your Execute for actually a big minion that would likely come next turn.
But do you play for tempo with this hand? I mean, it seems like he's kind of running out of stuff.
Is he? He's got the Acolyte.
That's going to help. That kind of makes it maybe a tiny bit better to potentially equip the Death's Bite here to try to get that whirlwind effect.
I mean, Death's Bite and armor.
Particularly given the Emperor from Hot Form, I think that you do need to try and play for some kind of tempo here, because you're just going to fall behind. It's not that you're trying to tempo out your opponent. You're trying to get ahead of them before they get ahead of you.
Well, we see just that there. Hot Form with considerably more options.
Thanks to Emperor Tharisin. Oh dear,
what
Swipe
a turn.
And Azure Drake takes out Neilio's entire board. That tempo he was looking for is now gone. And then Harrison Jones, not a card that's very good against the Druid deck.
It's very good against the Rogue deck,
you cannot,
by the way.
You cannot Harrison Jones your opponent's
maybe
claws.
Maybe that's where that 20% came from.
It could
maybe.
Be. Could be. I imagine it's very likely we'll see Deathspite take this out and then perhaps Acolyte of Pain come down. But what? Now this game, which not long ago looked to be heavily in Neleo's favor, is kind of slipping away from him.
Absolutely. I really don't like the Acolyte drop, though. I feel you need that card to actually get something more relevant.
Yeah, so he could wait with it, just in case there is a Keeper of the Crow waiting. The Deathspite likely to swing again on the following turn, and then you can secure the extra draw with the Acolyte.
But at the same time, given his opponent's use of Emperor Tharasin, I don't know that he wants to... If his opponent did play Keeper the next turn, that significantly reduces the amount of options that he has, and I think that Neleo is going to be looking for more possible tools himself. Maybe expensive card, but he does choose to save the Acolyte for next turn. I suppose he does have the Execute, so he's guaranteed to have at least some sort of play to go along with the Acolyte as well.
That's true.
Our Ancient of War comes down. The reason we see Big Taunts go into the second charge of a Deathspite is because it kind of denies the residual Execute play. Mm-hmm. Here, if he wants to execute that Ancient of War, he actually just has to take 5 damage.
Although Neleo does have the second copy of Deathspite or the Fiery Works, which he could play to replace his Deathspite, which also would trigger the Death Rattle and
that
allow him to execute without taking
damage. That actually is
possible.
He could Acolyte, then play the other's Deathspite, mm-hmm. then execute to save himself 5. But is a charge of Deathspite worth 5 HP and a potential tempo loss? Because otherwise he could gain something that he could play with the Acolyte.
Well, it's not even really a charge of Deathspite, because he would attack with the Deathspite that's already in play.
I actually like that a lot. Especially, or like another reason for that is that if there was a Harrison Jones in Hotform's hand, it would have most likely come down on the previous turn.
So he could even play Acolyte and either the Deathspite or the War Axe. Yeah, it looks like he's going with exactly that play. Playing the Deathspite to trigger the Death Rattle of his original Deathspite, which allows him to draw a card of Acolyte of Pain and trigger the Execute to kill the Ancient of War without actually having to attack into it. So, really heads up play from Neleo.
And no respect for Harrison Jones there.
Nope, because of that, Deathspite is the best card he can use it on, and Hotform didn't use it on the previous Deathspite, and there was only one card draw that happened after that.
All right, well, Neleo he wants to find Brawl now, what he's looking for here against this board.
It's a pretty good one, too.
It's okay, but I mean, look at Hotform's hand. He has Force of Nature plus Savage Roar. This board is threatening to do so much damage, and...
The thing is, though, like, Neleo's drawn 2 cards here, and that's a really big deal.
Well, he drew 2 cards thanks to that hitting his Acolyte. He only has the one charge, the 2 charges left in Deathspite, so he wouldn't be able to actually activate. He chose not to attack last turn.
Yep, picks up a shield block, but he's still in so much trouble. What is the card that he would hope to get if we use Shield Slam?
The thing is, Shield Slam would be good. Even if he did find something like Brawl, I think he's actually still in a lot of trouble. Those 3 minions.
He could just Shield Maiden up so he has another turn left in this game.
Alright, so Neleo is at 32 health, which sounds like a lot, but Hotform has.
That's 10. That's
enough.
10
yeah.
plus 6.
I believe that's actually
plus
enough.
16. Yeah. Oh, and the Druid of the Claw plus another 6. That's like 34, I think.
I think he's a mana short of the Druid of the Claw.
One mana short, but it is still enough.
Oh, I believe Force of Nature plus Savage Roar is 14. The board is 10. Another 6.
16. So it's
16 to 30.
Oh, so he's 1 damage off. It's actually 1 off.
Yeah. And then Elistrasa comes down.
The boom. Good dude.
Yeah, I don't know if you get our math right. 16 gap. Plus 14.
How much is
this? 31, I believe. I believe this is 31 damage. So I believe he is actually 1 damage off lethal.
Yeah, he is. He could get a Boombot to face before. So that would do it.
That's a little optimistic, I think.
But I mean, in case that it doesn't go to face, you can just use a Treant on the Shield Maiden to finish it off.
Wow. Boombot, do it! Do it! No lethal.
And 1 damage off lethal for Hotform. He still has a really impressive board here that Alexstrasza has to come down.
Yeah.
But even then, look at Hotform's board. He has the Dr. Boom and a bunch of damage and that Druid of the Claw in his hand. He's still, despite not quite having lethal, still.
Yeah, he's still commanding
in a really good spot.
Particularly
here.
Because BGH just challenges Alistraza. It challenges more than the entire turn, really.
Yeah, I mean, with the Dr. Boom there, the Shield Maiden, even with the weapon, can't take out Dr. Boom.
No, it'll have to take out the 2-3.
Without attacking into Dr. Boom directly, which is just 7 damage. It's so much.
I guess you would consider just going face with the 5, but that doesn't feel too great either. There is another consideration here. If perhaps you play the Grommash and armor up, or play the Armorsmith.
Whoa.
That's
Grommash Armorsmith.
That's pretty risky.
Grom Armorsmith attack with the weapon.
It's an interesting play. So risky, though.
Yeah, I can't really see. All right, so, yeah. Neilio does find the...
He has lethal here with a Boombot.
Once again, potential Boombot lethal.
Savage Roar would make it an actual lethal. As would Force of Nature.
Well, how about another Wild Growth?
Revise,
another try at either of those cards is going to be a fun experiment here.
See if he gets it.
And oh, there's Savage Roar.
Wow, there he goes. Yeah.
So Cat comes down. Cat is for fight. Innervate Savage Roar. And that is lethal damage for Hotform, who forces a game 5 against Neilio.
I believe Hotform did about 50 damage over the course of 2
much
turns.
Damage, yeah. Neilio was at 32, and then he was suddenly at 1, and then he was at 15, and then he was dead. That really showcases the explosive power of the combo Druid deck.
All right, well, the dreams are still alive for both players, though more vividly for Neilio here, as he has the Control Warrior against the Rogue. Now, Control Warrior is normally just going to do very well against any Rogue deck. On one hand, you can just armor up, and often in that game, you can just fatigue out the Rogue. Often you can just burn through every single card in the Rogue deck before they
can actually
kill you.
As the Warrior player, you don't even have to worry about the Rogue's life total all that much. You're not really trying to kill the Rogue quickly. All you need to do is keep removing every single minion on the board, and that way the Rogue will eventually only have spells.
Yeah, the power of Rogue really lies in their ability to take a tempo advantage against minion-based strategies with things like Backstab, things like SI Agent. Warrior doesn't care about that. Warrior cares about killing what you have and just staying alive until it dominates the board with big things.
The Warrior simply has more removal than the Rogue has minions.
And just the hero power, armor up, it eventually puts the Warrior out of range, especially with Justicar Trueheart and Shield Maiden and Shield Block. That big oil damage combo that we've seen win so many games this weekend, it just is not effective against Warrior.
Yep, quite a match yet to come. I'm sure you guys have many opinions about the players in the tournament, but we had a chance to ask Hotform what he thought about some of his competition.
The friendliness of the other players, I think, would be the most surprising part. The other players, although we're opponents, it feels really like comrades. When you're out there, you know, you're just hanging out, waiting for things to happen, you're discussing strategies, and you're a little guarded about your own tech choices and those kinds of things, but when you're just there hanging out, it feels really like you're with a bunch of friends. So I think that was surprising to me. I thought some people would be more tense about it, but it's a really great feeling the way it worked out.
The final game of this match. One player moves through to the BlizzCon Finals. Well, the other one goes to BlizzCon 2, but doesn't quite get to play on the same level.
Yeah, and will Hotform be able to become the first representative of the Americas region, or will Neilio move on to be the third representative of APAC? Let us know on Twitter there with hashtags AMWin or APACWin. And I mean, Hotform has said that he thinks it's going to be a very tough game going in.
Yeah, I mean, these players, again, they played against each other in their opening game, and Hotform ended up triumphing, but it was a very close 3-2, and here we are again in the similar spot where it is a 2-2 score. But Neilio has the match advantage, even though this Warrior deck has failed to produce a win in 2 tries now. In fact, it's been his only losing deck. It seems like it's pretty hard to go 0-3.
This is the match where his Warrior deck is at its strongest, because it really just interacts with the Rogue deck in a way that the Rogue deck is hoping to avoid.
Mm-hmm.
So Hotform, Violet Teacher, one of the cards that can actually generate a reasonable number of minions that can give him a strong start that he needs to put pressure on the Warrior.
One thing we actually haven't seen from Neilio's Warrior deck is a Whirlwind effect outside of the Deathspite. Often Warrior decks do include a Whirlwind, or more recently, Revenge.
Revenge has been popular, yes.
Just somewhat popular. But we have not seen it in Neilio's list, and that repetitive damage of the 1-1s isn't as easy to control for this type of deck, if that's the case, because you have the weapon hits, you have the shield slams, you have the executes, but these are not things you really want to use on 1-1 creatures that can just grind you down.
Yeah. He does have Brawl and he does have Berengeddon, but those are a bit slower, so it's possible that if Hotform is able to get out a quick Violet Teacher, that could be a road to victory.
Yeah. Does he actually have Brawl?
I believe he does. I believe we've seen him cast Brawl. He may not. It's possible. But I thought I had. It's a very
We've seen it draw zero times today.
Today, at least. Yeah, that's true.
On the first day, I'm not even sure we had an appearance. But that would be very weird if that is the case.
It would be surprising, because that is particularly if you are playing Control Warrior in a world you expect decks like Secret Paladin. It's one of your strongest cards. We do see the Berengeddon in Neilio's opening hand, much like in the first game where we saw Berengeddon among many other expensive legendaries.
Right, but in this hand, at least you have some things that you can play. Armorsmith on two, while it doesn't have as much of an impact as it does against more aggressive decks with smaller minions with far less health, it's still a presence, and he continues that presence with the Acolyte. He has the Bash to often trigger against one of the three or four drop creatures in the Rogue deck. We mentioned that most of the Rogue creatures are vulnerable to that three damage breakpoint, with the SI7 being vulnerable, with the Shredder being vulnerable. But really, it's going to be about this Violet Teacher. I think if you can pick up a prep and maybe some other cards you can play alongside it, things can get a little bit out of control.
Yeah, the hand is not looking too bad for Hotform. He does have an Azure Drake. That low tip can also be a key moment in the game. If he manages to get some kind of bot going to go for that low tip to prevent the Brawl.
Yeah, being able to generate a board and then protect it with Lotheb against removal effects is one of Hotform's strongest roads to victory. Neilio, again, sort of in the tank on turn two. I imagine we'll see him come out eventually and play this Armorsmith, but...
Well, the thing is, the Armorsmith doesn't actually challenge a single creature in the Rogue deck.
It's true.
But on the other, he might just be saving it for a turn where he can trigger Whirlwind Effect to get additional value out of the armor. So even if he doesn't Armorsmith here, I think that is a very fair way of playing.
Certainly, he could just choose to armor up. The health gain from armor up and being able to save your Armorsmith for later are both pretty relevant in this game. Yeah, Armorsmith does come down, and you know, even just getting a little bit of damage on the Rogue can be relevant. They do, as we were saying, use their life total as a resource. While it's not a matchup where generally comes down to that sort of thing, having the ability to pressure them is still valuable.
Yeah, Eviscerator, reasonable card to draw here. Not too bad. It allows him to remove some early threat from Neilio's side.
Hotform attacking into the Armorsmith, he does have that deadly poison in his hand. So
yeah, most likely he's going to reweapon deadly poison and go for the kill on the Armorsmith. And Neilio, realizing this, might choose not to Acolyte of Pain. But now that he's got a second one, he's probably going to choose the Acolyte of Pain.
Yeah, definitely. You don't want to hold out the two Acolytes
right
in your hand.
Yeah. What now? Also, with that Armorsmith in play, killing the Acolytes not only allows Neilio to dig to further cards, but it does get him a little bit of armor each time they do take damage.
And you absorb another three damage.
Yeah. And in a matchup where the Rogue deck does have a pretty limited amount of damage that it can deal, if you're able to remove its minions, that can add up and be very important. I
wonder. Neilio once again going down to the rope before making his play. He could choose the Acolyte on the middle or the one on the right side.
Which do you think he'll play?
I think he's gonna play the one from the middle.
All right. And he does. Good call.
Hey, yes. Speak to me.
All right. Well, and, there goes Shredder, which is not too bad. You might be able to play that next turn and save a higher mana turn for a Violet Teacher play.
The Shredder, one of the best cards against Warrior, because even though the weapon deals with the Shredder, but the Shredder still gets that 9 damage or so in, depending on what pops out of it.
I really like the kill on the Armorsmith. We kind of predict that he'd kill the Acolyte. I think we've just been seeing too much Patron Warrior in the last few weeks. The Acolyte is not as threatening of a card in the control type of Warrior of the lack of self-damage effects on your own minions. Yeah. And leaving the Acolyte up... actually, when you see a Warrior play an Acolyte that seems vulnerable, often they're doing that because they have to. So if you don't give him a draw next turn, they might just have another bad turn. And I actually, like, the more I see the situation, the more clear it is that killing the Armorsmith ends up being the better route.
It is true that without additional activators like Inner Rage, like Whirlwind, These Acolyte Commander are unlikely to get Neilio multiple cards, and by killing the Armorsmith first, he's able to also deny him additional armor from those minions.
It is possible to get punished by that if there was a Cruel Taskmaster in Neilio's hand, but I don't think... Have you even seen any Cruel Tasks from Neilio? Does he play that card?
We talked about seeing it.
I believe we have. I believe we've seen one.
I believe I have all. I've also seen it, but at the same time, there's been a few Warrior decks.
We've watched a lot of Blades of Warrior this week.
And down comes the Piloted Shredder, and Neilio's still without a weapon.
Yeah, Bash is going to answer this very well. Slam, though. Seems a bit clunky here.
I think what we'll probably see is Bash and Neilio hoping that a two health minion comes out.
No, he wants two three.
Rather, two attack
or
minion is what I meant.
2-1.
Yeah, 2-1 would be really good.
If a 2-1 comes out, if there's
I think he's quite happy slamming here just to cycle through his deck. I think a 1-3 might be ideal, actually.
So, The slam there, I think that keeping the slam to possibly use the other Bash to kill something like an Azure Drake may be what he's looking to do.
I think this Bash might be a little bit stronger. Just use it first, because one very likely outcome is the 2-3, and in that case he could slam the 2-3 first and then use the Acolyte to finish it off.
So he gets the best of both worlds, really.
Actually, the best place to wait and then do that.
Yeah. Every time, as soon as the rope starts burning, he goes for his move.
And there's a 3-2, so not what Neilio was hoping
for. You might still go for the Bash here. Or the slam.
Possible.
Right. Might do it, yeah.
Yes, looks like he wants to try to find an opportunity to get an extra card with that Acolyte. Remove that from the board.
I believe Azure Drake is going to hit the board here. Again, you have such nice plays with the Violet Teacher, but the more you wait, the higher the payout, but also the higher the risk. But considering it's such a bad matchup, I feel like the risk portion of this is fairly irrelevant. I think the only way you're winning is by taking risks.
Yeah, he is going for it here, and he's just saw a slam and a bash, no weapons. So he thinks that it might be even difficult for Hotform to remove that this right now.
Yeah. Might be, but Shield Slam says otherwise.
Yeah, it's gonna do it.
Shield Slam and actually Geddon is going to counter the play quite a bit.
He can't Geddon this turn.
No, but next turn, the 1-1s that could start grinding down the Warrior's health pool are really not going to be able to accomplish that.
Mm, true.
Shield Slam fairly obvious here. He's still going to have 5 mana remaining, so we could see the shield block and armor up, or the Armorsmith maybe.
The Armorsmith is kind of nice to potentially challenge these 1-1s if he isn't certain to play the Baron Geddon next turn.
Also, he could just draw first with the Shield Slam if he's going to do the Shield Bash if he's going to do the Shield Slam and Armorsmith play.
How about just bashing that Violet Teacher right now in preparation for the Geddon for next turn?
That's not bad either.
It's reasonable though if your opponent does play a large minion, then you are sort of committed to playing the Baron Geddon and then potentially attack into it. Like if he played low job,
he might get into trouble for that.
Looks like he doesn't want to maximize the amount of armor he's going to get throughout the course of the game. He's probably already decided that he's going to try to fatigue the Rogue out, which, a viable strategy.
It turns out
to work a lot of the time.
Only 2 minions remaining in Hotform's hand right now.
And the backstab plus one of these minions able to take out the Armorsmith.
Makes Geddon play a little bit less attractive too.
Yeah, this means that Baron Geddon is not super exciting. And this is a matchup where you'll often see that Grommash Hellscream just uses a removal effect. In many matchups, Grom is most effective as a finisher. You just do a big amount of burst damage when you damage it with something like a Death's Bite, Death Rattle. But against Rogue, again, you were just able to remove all of their threats and frequently just fatigue them out because they do have so many cards that are so low impact. They're strong tempo cards, but not strong value cards.
I really feel like you have to shield block here, because if you get a Death's Bite, it's basically the nuts. The game is almost over.
Almost. And if he doesn't get it, the shield slam is still quite all right. I wonder.
Certainly a reasonable option here. And again, he does have potentially that Grom to use on the Azure Drake if he does choose to wait on it.
I just feel if he gets in here, it can turn out to be a disaster. We know it will turn out to be a disaster.
It will not go well for him, it's true. So shield block, he finds a shield maiden, does just use the shield slam and armor up. So now Neilio, his health is going way up, and Hotform still just with a hand of pretty low impact cards. Another Azure Deck is a nice draw, though. It does give him the ability to dig deeper into his deck to find more.
I feel like the Lothar is stronger because if you Azure Drake, you can just die to a Death Spite.
It's true. It either dies Death Spite or the eight mana. It does have 4 health, so Grom would actually take it out quite easily.
Oh, that's Taskmaster.
Yeah. It does exist.
Yeah, wow. Confirmed.
Oh, it's a tough play, though.
Shield Maiden armor up, maybe?
Yeah, I think I like the Shield Maiden armor up.
The Chromash doesn't seem to accomplish much here.
No, you need a little bit more mana for it to work. Mm-hmm.
So, once again, Nilio taking his time.
I imagine that he may actually even be saving that Berengedin to play alongside Bash to kill a larger minion in a single turn.
Mm-hmm.
He hasn't had a great opportunity to play it where it would dominate the board, and when you do get to 10 mana and you can play both of those at the same time, you're able to kill bigger minions at once.
He could have set that up earlier, as Sevilla noted, against the Vile Teacher, and I kind of wonder how that line of play would have turned out, but he's still winning considerably, so I guess it's not.
He does choose just to play Berengedin.
Wow, interesting.
Okay.
That is a dangerous play.
Well, this does leave Lothar at a point where he will be able to potentially remove it with the Bash next turn.
I find that play slightly strange.
Actually, Hofram can start pushing for damage. He can do Sounds the Deckhand. Mm-hmm. He can do Sap. He can do... even more things now.
I kind of feel like that was the opening that Hofram needed. Right now, he's finally going to have a big minion stick to the board, remove the threat from his opponent, and gonna extend his lead.
And we do see Eviscerate come down, so Hotform doesn't want the Berengedin to come back with that sap. And 5 damage comes in.
Do you think the 2 from the Southsea deckhand is much of a risk at this point?
I think that Hotform may be a little bit worried about just extending too much into a brawl. It's generally not a card that's good in this matchup, and with the Tinker Sharpsword Oil in his hand, that Southsea deckhand can represent a lot of burst damage if he needs it.
Yep, probably going to keep it for the combination with the oil.
And there's Death Spite. Actual fist pump from Nilio. He's like, finally, the best card in my deck.
Yeah, he's able to Death Spite and Bash to clear the board. And still armor up again. Gain some more armor from the Bash. You still have the Gromash. You have an activator with a Death Spite, another one with a Cruel Task. You have the Shieldmaid for more armor. You basically have a full toolbox, whatever you need, you know. Yeah.
We did say that that was potentially the window that Hotform needed, but that Death Spite may be the nail in his coffin here. That is a huge draw from Nilio, able to clear the board and just gain a bunch more armor with Bash and armor up.
He could actually even set up lethal here. He's not going to do it. No way you go for that kind of risk. But he could play the Death Spite and bash his opponent's face to put him down to low enough for the Chrome to Cruel Taskmaster.
Face.
Wow. Yeah, that's
actually what
are we playing right now? And he can actually still armor up. He could have 38. Is there a real risk? Like, what could Hotform actually have?
I don't know. Does he even play a heal button?
It looks like he just goes. Yeah, goes for the conservative line of play. I don't blame him.
It is
flashy to try and two-turn kill him here, but you don't need to do anything like that in this matchup. You are a big favorite if you just kind of play it methodically.
Yeah, absolutely unnecessary to go for that kind of play. Hotform picking up a sprint.
Yeah, one good draw deserves another. Hotform picks up sprint and 4 more cards, but again,
Fan's
he doesn't have that many strong cards
nice.
In his deck.
Blade Flurry is huge.
Second sprint.
All right, well, he can draw as many cards as he wants with that second sprint, but he is facing down Nilio's enormous health total and a Shield Maiden poised to come down. The Big Game Hunter is pretty unusual as a card in a Rogue deck.
It is. I would be
it's not unusual as a card in Hotform's deck.
It's true. He has played a lot of Big Game Hunters in all of his decks, really.
Yeah.
It's so tempting with just Grom here, because that's the bigger minion and you have the time to play it, but if he went for that play, he would be horribly punished by that BGH.
It looks like he may do it.
That might be a game-deciding moment right here.
The thing is, we talked about using Grom for removal. That's kind of the case when you go back and forth. But when the Rogue just has a hand of 9 cards, you kind of want to start thinking about closing out the game.
I don't know that we've actually seen Big Game Hunter in Hotform's hand.
No,
I
believe we have
match.
Not.
I don't believe we have not. So this is actually... Grom is a difficult minion for Rogue to typically remove. He could even just play Grom in attack phase and not attack with his weapon. Like, I think that's also a totally reasonable option.
Yeah.
He does choose to just play things safe, go with the Shield Maiden armor up.
Wow.
Now, Hotform prep. All right.
I think you just play a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, it looks like he's just going to go
sprint.
Big burst damage here. Also probably clears off the Shield Maiden with the flurry, I have to imagine, will come
yeah,
down.
Probably wants to deal as much damage to his opponent's face as possible. Carefully sequencing, they are going with the deckhand first.
Whoa, so we've broken them through the armor!
Yeah, finally, first blood!
Yeah.
All the way down to 26 after getting attacked for 17 in one turn. We do have the Taskmaster here that can easily clean off this deckhand. Or Emilio could go Grom face. It's possible. It's possible you just see Grom go to the face.
I think because nothing's been sapped this game, if you play the Grom, the most likely action from your opponent is the sap. And if you go face with Grom, put your opponent at 12, you have the slightly unpredictable finisher with Grom plus Cruel Task in the following turn. It seems like a good plan, unless you actually know for sure that Big Game Hunter is a part of the Rogue deck, which, I mean, is not impossible, as these players have played against together, against each other and together, but that would be pretty wild.
I think 9 out of 10 players. Yeah, 9 out of 10 players would go for the Grom here if they don't know that there's a Big Game Hunter in the deck right now.
Yeah, we did hear actually Hot from in his winner's interview against Neilio. He was asked by Rachel about his Rogue deck, and he was very cagey about it. And I have to imagine this is why.
Wow.
He doesn't want his opponents to know that he has cards like Big Game Hunter. And this is going to be a big swing. This could be a defining moment here.
Could be. Hot from still has a few more minions left in his deck.
He's going to prep Sprint before the BGH.
Yep, Shredder would probably be the best possible draw.
Shredder would
along.
Not be playable.
Oh, no, actually. A tree drop. Yeah. SI agent. Yep, that's better.
All right. Yeah, and the Big Game Hunter takes out Grom and SI agent. And now, Hotform's on the board with a reasonable amount of minions. He does have a second Tinkers and Blinkfully left in his hand. That can do a lot of damage very fast. Sludge Belcher, not terribly exciting when you know your opponent has drawn a lot of cards and still has sap left.
You have the clear Brawl Away one minion Cruel Task execute.
It is an option, and it's actually not an unreasonable option.
Oh, that's an unreasonable option.
I don't think it is. This is a matchup where your opponent doesn't have very many minions, and the only way you lose, really, is to consistent minion damage.
I just feel two is not threatening enough. If you use Brawl against two, you probably just secure the loss against the next turn after considering
what,
you just sprinted.
What's a better opportunity to play a Brawl? Like, what do you...
Three minions.
Well, yes, that's true. But how often does the Rogue actually deploy all that many minions into the board?
I think if you play a Sludge Belcher, you're getting sapped, and Hotform's playing a third minion.
Maybe.
I wouldn't hate the Brawl here,
to be honest. I actually think it's a totally reasonable line of play here. Just clear their board. He does choose to go Sludge Belcher.
5 cards in the Rogue deck. Yeah, so not much, but that's enough to close out the game before you die to fatigue, I think.
It is. And Blood Mage Thalnos. Yep,
that kind of allows him to be not even like necessarily sap that. He could just go for back steps and fan of knives with that Blood Mage. A lot of options for Hot Form right now.
Yeah, so he does go with prep Tinker Sharp Sword Oil before he plays the Blood Mage if he does choose to, because he wants to guarantee it lands on one of the minions on the board.
That signals the sap.
Yeah, there's the sap.
What if he's going to cycle a fan of knives? Seems like he's going to go for one fan.
Yeah, there's a heal bot.
Is nice. You might not die to fatigue or just a weapon draw here.
Mm-hmm. 14 going to Neilio's face right here.
Third creature.
Ooh.
Give me that brawl.
I don't know about that.
Uh-oh.
Seems very likely that Neilio would have the brawl. We, of course, have the information that it's in there. But if you hot form, the game is quite far already, and no brawl has been
played. One concern that I have is you have much more potential damage if you hold back on the spell damage for next turn. That's why I think there's some reason for him to hold it back just for his own hand, regardless of what the warrior might have.
That's also true.
Dr. Boom would have been good a little while ago, but not so exciting right now when you're facing down so much damage in Neilio's seat.
Yeah, you kind of have to play the taunt.
He has to execute the 6-3. And the taunt, he can actually do all of that. He can go for the Belcher, he can go for the Taskmaster, execute, and even armor up afterwards.
That's right.
That does potentially allow Hotform to flurry away the Taskmaster and Belcher for 5 with the Blood Mage.
It does.
Actually, Hotform has a really good chance here.
Yeah, this is a game that went from looking like Neilio was running away with it to very, very close.
Hotform with those double sprints has been able to stay in the game, even though the card value for a warrior is higher.
These last few turns are just so, so important. One small slip up here means that you just lose, and your dream to play at the BlizzCon Finals is over.
And Nelio does go with the Brawl, so I think he's going to make the Cruel Taskmaster execute play. Yeah.
Executes just to deal one damage.
After taking enormous amount of damage from those last turn, he decides to finally brawl away that board.
Yeah, but now we still have a decent play. We have the Blood Mage fan into a heal bot.
Oh, Shredder. Ooh, Shredder. From the top. More minions is exactly what he needed.
Mm-hmm.
And that backstep deals with the Cruel Taskmaster quite easily.
Yeah, just deploying more minions, get that guy off the board, push for damage with these guys. The Belcher still threatening to die to Blood Mage Thalnos plus Blade Flurry. Execute
Ooh,
with no activator.
Card.
Yeah. This is slipping away from Nelio here.
Wait a second. Hawthorne still has a sap left in his deck. So he might be able to force draw it.
He sapped the Berengen.
Did he?
He sapped the Berengen. No, he executed.
No, he eviscerated.
He does have a strike.
No,
you're right.
There should be one sap remaining. Some players only play one, but I would expect Hawthorne to be playing two in this situation. But wow.
Hotform felt like he was a huge underdog going into this matchup, but right now he looks like he's ahead.
Yeah.
But the Dr. Boom's still quite powerful, and Hotform doesn't have that extra bit of damage to actually lethal Nelio just yet.
Well, I think his other card's Eviscerate, so...
That would do it, I guess.
So Nelio thinking through what possible options he has here.
Well, Dr. Boom and Sludge Belcher.
Chooses to go Sludge Belcher.
I think if he gets Eviscerate, it's over, because he can do Blade Flurry for 5, Fan for 2, and then Eviscerate
five,
for 5.
5, 7. He exactly lethal with that.
He might still draw it. He might still draw it, because the Fan might draw Eviscerate. I think he has Eviscerate and Sap in his deck right now. It's a 50-50 chance to win the game.
He had one card left. He just almost had a card.
Well, that's going to be an Eviscerate. Right? Is it? Oh, it's a Sap.
It is the other Sap.
Okay. So I guess he did use Eviscerate, so I guess I miscounted.
Yeah, I mean, obviously you play two Eviscerates, so both of those have
to play. Gets Nelio down to 3 life. That's gonna be it.
Doomsayer!
No,
Doomsayer still
not
doesn't
enough.
Do it. No, it still does not do
no,
it.
No, there's nothing that
he
Nelio
has to armor
can do.
Up, go to one, and the rogue actually kills him with the hero power if that happens.
That is true. The rogue hero power, even if there is a Doomsayer coming for Hotform's Shredder, still going to be able
what
to end the game.
No.
With 0 cards in his deck and a
Hotform
sap in his hand.
Felt like he was such an underdog. He felt like his only way to win this match was to dodge this particular matchup, and he's on the verge of winning it. There's nothing Nelio can do.
There's literally nothing he can do. Hotform has won this game. We have our first player from the America region to qualify for the BlizzCon Finals.
I mean, maybe Hotform takes mercy on him. He is Canadian.
No chance.
You know, he's just going to say, oh, no, no.
No. Canadians are nice, but then when
not,
there's something at stake,
nice.
The niceness goes away. Nelio's just thinking, maybe there's something I can't think of that helps me in this situation.
Snap Tangle, and that is it. Hotform will advance to the BlizzCon main stage, top 8.
Hotform advances on the back of beating Nelio twice in extremely close matches, 3-2 both times in some fairly unlikely circumstances, just as we saw there.
Yeah. Hotform gave himself 20% chance to win that match. He did it on the big stage with so much on the line.
That's why we play the games.
Yeah, and that was really, really crazy. So it's still evened out. No region has more than 2 players to advance yet. But coming up next, we have a Ping Ping Ho versus a Purple. Ping Ping Ho is from the Asia Pacific region, and Purple is from the Canada region, which I believe is part of the Americas. So we'll have to see. We'll have to see if there is going to be balance or a little bit of imbalance in the favor of the Asia Pacific region.
Will it be Purple who brings balance to the force?
We'll have to see. I'm sure Purple would like that. But for now, let's hear from the other Canadian, the more recent winner, Hotform.
Thanks so much, gentlemen. I'm here with Hotform, our first America's player to make it to the top 8. And you went into that final matchup with your rogue against his warrior. What was going through your mind?
I mean, they had been long games the whole series. Going into that match, I'm definitely unfavored, so I was pretty nervous. But I got through it. It's time to party. Oh, man, I got like a week till my next match, so I'm definitely going to enjoy some parties. There's so many cool people here. Getting to hang out with all the other teams has been fantastic. So it's been great. Thank you.
Yeah, your chat has been working hard for you, cheering for you. Is there any chance you're going to be able to stream before BlizzCon?
Yeah, I'm going to try my best. I really want to hang out with some of you guys. I've been missing you. You know, it's tough sometimes when I can't stream, but I'll definitely be doing my best to get there.
Well, congratulations once again. A very happy winner here on to the top 8 at BlizzCon. We have one more match coming up. Please don't go anywhere.
Our final game of our pre-BlizzCon qualifier is going to happen coming up. Before that, before we really get to see what our final BlizzCon lineup will be like, we want to thank our sponsors to make this tournament happen and of course, getting it all together. And also before that, let's just have a quick look at some of the highlights from the last few games. And of course, it's brought to you by Windows 10 Game DVR.